Right, so this is just a quick overview after we've gone through everything, now that we know.
Spoiler alert, it works.
Spoiler alert, it works. But we just wanted to mention a few things. First of all, we are going to mention various other models. This is a 98 Chevy Blazer, of course, but this may be applicable to S10 trucks, GMC Sonomas, Jimmy's, Oldsmobile Bravadas. But there will be differences with all these sorts of things, especially with the pickups, because they kind of tended to flip-flop around with that sort of stuff. But it's just here, and if we forget to mention something specific, it's because I don't know about it. I only have the one rig. quick overview. If you are going to plan on doing this job, to get to the vent defrost doors, which is what we're after.
Yeah.
There's a few components that need to come out. the dashboard, which is what we're doing most of the teardown for. Not teardown, but take apart. And so you need to take the entire dashboard out to get to that. You also need to remove the black box in front here that contains your evaporator core and your blower fan. And to remove that, you kind of need to take this fender off. We are here today with the blunder child.
The blunder child. thank you. Yes, so we have here our, my 98 Chevrolet S10 style Blazer.
I need a new air conditioning system, and I have a new air conditioning system. It's just a matter of putting those pieces right there into that thing. And since I kind of figured there's not really anything that I've found about taking apart the dashboard in this, I'm going to document some of that. So long story short.
I don't even know how long the story is yet.
Yeah, it's professionalism, mm-hmm. Cohesion.
Pretzels.
The first step for taking apart the dashboard is... Well, my first step, since I've already modified it, is to just pull off this top thing right here. I can do it real simply because, as you can see, I've taken off the stock metal clips. That will expose some of the mounting screws. Full disclaimer here, I should mention I've never actually taken out the dashboard in its full entirety, so we might be doing a little bit of trial and error here, but I will try my best to make sure this makes as much sense as possible.
You may not have noticed this, but we are not professionals. We do not do this for a living. We do this because we can. Do what we must because we can.
And because I'm on air conditioning. The first step after taking out that plastic bit on top is I'm going to remove this kind of faux decorative plastic
faceplate.
Faceplate, sure. And to do that, you first need, there's a fastener right under there, and that should be this 9/32. I'm hoping it's the 9. Yep, 9/32. Right, now after you've got that, take your keys, and you gotta put it, let's put the parking brake on, you gotta put it all the way down, and this is where your flathead screwdriver comes in handy. Because then you very carefully, daintily, start to,
like a pirouetting ballerina,
pry it off. You really want to be gentle with it because it's metal clips holding plastic pieces in and together.
And kind of geriatric plastic at that.
Now this is the part where you stop because you remember you need to do something else first. Like I said, this is going to be a bit take out. So there's a fastener. You see this hole there? There's a fastener in there that needs to come out. And then there's one on the other side in a similar hole, either side of the steering wheel. There might at one point have been fasteners along the bottom that you also need to do, but I removed those because they're annoying. Yeah, actually, right there. And if you can see where my finger is, right over there, you might need to remove those fasteners as well. I've removed those a long time ago. This is on top of this piece. So we need to pull this piece part away far enough for this piece to come out.
You need to drop the cod piece before the chest armor comes off.
Yeah. I just want to make sure I'm being reasonably clear about how this goes. Keep track of your fasteners. Make sure they fall down some godforsaken hole.
Yeah, like the defroster duct that's right next to where you're talking about.
Yeah. Do you have your magnetic tray?
Yeah,
let's
grab the magnet tray.
Let's grab the magnet tray.
Oh, yes. Super professional magnet tray.
Yep. That way it's harder to lose them.
Yeah. We'll still set it up here so that you can miss and put them down to the defroster bit.
Yes. This is pretty good and thick, so this we can pop out without too much worry. Flathead screwdriver, of course. And as you can see, there were also, at one point, fasteners that went in there and on the other side as well. Looks basically just the same as that. That did hold this piece in. As you can see, again, I have removed them.
Because parts left over means you rebuilt it better.
Yes. Or at least more intelligently than Chevy did.
Doesn't take much, though.
You may need to adjust your steering wheel in order to do this. If you don't have one of the steering wheels that adjusts, I don't know, you're...
Sacrifice a goat.
Yes, that's the standard Chevy procedure. So now comes the fun part. Now that you've popped this off, you have to take off the electrical connections. Let's start with the 4x. If you don't have 4x, I don't know if you need to... I don't know what's... I guess it's just a blank plate here that you don't need to worry about. Again, this is where the flathead screwdriver comes in handy. I'm going for the white one towards the bottom here first. And on my side, there's a little plastic clip here that you need to lift up on. And then doing that, in theory, you can just, yep, pull it out. And this one, how does this go? Oh yeah, back on the other, of course they make it so you can't see exactly what you're doing, but on
down at the bottom there?
Yeah, on the bottom side, there's a clip you have to spring up and then pull out, I believe.
Chevrolet, because who doesn't like working by braille? Also.
I've just stabbed myself on the mirror. This is what I just got. It's from one of those combination screwdrivers. You can pick them up at Home Depot where you change them out. I like it because you can get the flathead and just have a very, very small flathead for fiddling around with this sort of stuff.
Basically, just a tiny little rock bar.
Yeah. There we go. You see that? On the bottom, you've got to press that in and then pull it out. And there, that's that.
Is your 4x disconnected?
This one, which control on mine, controls the rear hatch and the rear wipers. On my side, over here, again, where it's difficult to see, there's just another clip like that one that you push in and pull it out.
One thing that makes this easier is apparently popping out the whole unit.
Yeah. Actually makes it a lot easier because there you can see what we're up against. Mm-hmm. Push that in and pull it out.
Yum-da-da-dum.
And from there, just shove it back in.
Nice.
That's that. And finally, we have our custom-made junk. There is one plug for the light switch. You press that down, pulls out.
Ah.
If you have the fog lamps, this will also be connected in. And even if you don't have the fog lamps, it'll probably still be connected into that blank plate. Keep in mind, that might be there, and it's just another one of those clips. I leave mine unclipped because it's not doing jack. And so once you've got that piece out, it can sod off. Now this is the part where I actually like to kind of leave that in for a second. Because now we've got these black case panels. And they all use the same 9/32 fasteners. And there's a bunch of them, so you just gotta kinda have to look around and find them all. Most of these fasteners are towards the front here, and they go up. But there are a few cases where you will have fasteners further in the back going in. And depending on the how much your system has been torn apart, there was also a fastener that went to something in here that I no longer have. And also, one more thing to keep in mind is the OBD2 scanner port here is also held into this piece right here. So just keep that in mind when you're taking that piece out.
Do not be afraid, folks. This is only a drill.
Panel one, this is just on the corner here, and
I just get it to cram up against those threaded bits. I think there used to be nuts that used to attach them, but they work just fine with the, you know, schlump them in, bolt it up, and good to go. One thing I would like to make very clear is I'm only using this drill for removal. I definitely would not recommend using it for installation of these things, because they will likely strip out. So now this panel here, this is the one, this is directly under the driver's side, and it's still got, as you can see, it's connected with the OBD, the scan port. Just the same fasteners.
At least they're all the same size, that makes things easy.
All the same size so far. And once we get all under all of this, that's where things start to get a little fun. Now this, you just kind of have to turn it sideways and push it through the angle bit. And then this piece can go away.
Oh.
I wonder if that went to something at some point. While we're here, under here, we've got the brake release cable, which is mounted up to this thing. The easiest way to take this panel off is to just pull off the cable right here. How I take care of this is I pull it in with my other hand here on the actual lever, hold it in place with my finger, and then push the lever out, and then try my best. It's hard to show, but I just manipulate the wire until it's off of the hook here.
So basically, it's just got a fat end on the cable that you have to remove from the clipsing epoxy.
Yep. And then this rubber bung just pops out, and that's all you have to do to disconnect that. You may need to route the cable release through. You might need to do some jiggling and bodging to get it to come all the way in and out, but I've done it before. Next should be this middle plastic bolster, which we've gotten all of. Connector for the power output. On this, can break right at the point where I tried to repair it last time. Yay! From this part, that's the part that I really know how to do.
From here on out, things get interesting.
Things get a little interesting.
This is the part where we ask our questions to our sage mentor, Manuel, the factory service Manuel. So we're going to be working around airbags, so we're going to disconnect the battery, and as per the manual, also pull the fuse and let this thing sit for like 10 minutes.
Bravely bold Sir Service, rode forth from Camelot.
SIR on the inside is the 15 amp fuse at number 16 position. Yeah. There. There's four fasteners, one at each corner. Take these out, same size, 30 seconds. So once you've got the fasteners out, you can bring it forward. I don't know, in this car, it's got a wired plug. I know in certain Chevys, like my Astro van, this is the whole instrument cluster. It literally just has a plug on the back that clicks in. So if you're having some trouble getting it out, be kind of careful. Make sure you don't break anything. But I think with most Blazers, the plug just comes out and you can pinch the two connectory bits together and kind of wiggle it back and forth until it eventually,
until you hear this map,
comes out. Put this someplace that where it won't break. And continuing on, we to remove the radio, there's two more fasteners, one either side. And yeah, take the radio out. There's an antenna that just pulls out. These wires you would not see in your unit, but there would be this big plug that will not want to come out. But by golly, it's going to. Took out the HVAC controls. They're normally clipped in. They will also have some fasteners. And just going to go ahead and remove the connectors on the back, electrical connector there. How does that go? Okay, this either end just have squeeze connectors, and then that pulls off.
Squeeze and pull, oh, yeah. Forever.
That one was fun. I remember that one now.
Is that the vacuum bastard?
Yep. This gray thing in the back here, that just pulls out. It's a weird thing. Way in the back there, there's that red and blue clip that I think feels like it hasn't, yeah, just another squeeze type connector. Hold that in. Actually, it looks a lot like that other connector. I didn't know what was under the dash, but...
And now you got the nuclear power plant.
And then we've got the vacuum son of a gun that, let me see, I believe... Aha! This is where we get out our quarter-inch drive.
Quarter-inch.
Let's see. The only thing holding that in now is the knob on the front, which just pulls off.
Just gotta yank the knob.
And what I like to do with this is just put these screws, kind of half-thread them back in where they're supposed to go. The rest of these are pretty well interchangeable. Some of them have different sized washers, but you know, if you find the right spaced holes, then they'll fit. These ones are kind of unique so far. we're gonna take out the glove box now. So if you take this apart, make sure the door's closed, obviously. Same 9:30 seconds. Now, support, open up, and there we go.
Dun, 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 dun.
And this can go away. And again, this is a real challenge, and that's partly why we're making this video, is because it's really hard to know. Oh, that looks like a relay. I recall vaguely you might need to take out these speaker covers. What really comes in handy is a tool like this.
If you don't have a little angly thing, this actually works a little better. It's a stubby as hell screwdriver. So once you remove the speaker grills and unplug the sensor here, you can see that that whole speaker grill is for this tiny ass little tweeter speaker here.
I figure I should also mention, I believe if you have the automatic HVAC system, in which case I'm so sorry, but I think you will have another sensor in this top plastic piece that you need to take out as well. I forgot to mention that earlier.
Mm. So yeah, now we've just got this row of fasteners along the top, and we're hoping that if we pull those out, the whole dashboard will sort of pivot forward on some kind of magical... Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm also assuming that you need to take some of these out, possibly.
Yeah.
I'm honestly not sure.
Well, again, let's buzz these bastards out and see what happens. Okay, so there are a couple of screws in here. Tweeter comes out, and now I just gotta figure out how to unplug the bastard.
After consulting Manuel, we have a slightly better idea on what we're doing. We do need to remove the speakers, or at least I say we need to remove the speakers, and also need to replace the...
Remove,
thank you. Remove the metal knee bolster, which I believe is... Flashlights handy. Is pretty much just nuts right there. So we will need a deep socket, but just, yeah, looks like that's all that holds this in. And then that bracy bit right there and on the other side, I believe those need to be disconnected, possibly the where they attach on the other ends as well. Yeah. And then, trying to see, okay, yeah.
Is that bit in there, or?
If you look right there, that...
That bugger.
That bugger, that silver bolt right there, that needs to come out, and then there's another one similar to that, same size by the looks of it, on this end, that needs to come out. And in theory, I think that's about everything we need. We will need to shift the lever down to get that out of the way, but yeah,
What could possibly go wrong?
And if that doesn't work, I have an electric chainsaw and the will to use it.
We're going to hope he doesn't need to.
That's about plan C at the moment.
That's about plan D at the moment.
Getting this out was not that difficult, except it was by braille. This was pushed into there. If you just pop this out from underneath, it's much easier to undo.
Right, so now, because Chevy, we're switching from a 9/32 to a 10mm to remove the knee bolster, which is here to, you know, bolster your knees and buckle them in if you're in a crash. As you can see, these are, you will probably need a deep socket for these. Yeah, luckily we have enough quarter inch extensions that this isn't too difficult.
Here's the scuzzy and full of gunk knee bolster
that we're going to go clean out.
All right, now that the knee bolster's out, it's time to take out the whatever the heck these little brackety things are.
Brackety brackets, same 10 mil for these fasteners as well.
Okay, here's this bugger out. It was clipped on. I unclipped it and pulled it out so that I could get to it more easily. And then this little red thing just has a catch on it here that you just push down and it slides through this little slot to let it all come apart so that it can't, you know, vibrate out or something.
Oh, they've got to be fucking kidding me.
Now what?
So, apparently, according to the powers that be, these brackety things that those bolt into,
mm-hmm.
those apparently are supposed to come out.
Mm-hmm.
Which means you have to undo the nuts all the way down in there.
I can't even see what you're talking about.
I can just barely see what I'm talking about. Okay, the fasteners you see before you are for the brackety things either side of the steering column. These are the easy ones. The hard ones are behind this thing. We'll cross that, we'll burn that bridge when we get to it, but yeah, it's, those have got to come out, and they're just right behind where the knee bolster mounted in. This is the first bracket to come out, and as you can see, that's where the, that's the bit that slots in and then the nuts go on. And then this is what the angle bracket mounted onto.
So, funny story. I had my head under there trying to stare at a bolt, yeah. And all of a sudden this thing goes chunk.
I was undoing this thing because the other bracket's difficult to get to. And, as you can see, you know. Yeah, let's see. Can we get it out with that one bracket still in place?
All right, so it's fighting us a little bit as it's coming out, but as you can see, we've got it forwards. We've got the steering wheel down into the 10-year-old trying to drive position.
We do have a few electrical connectors that probably should be disconnected.
There's a door jam switch right there that plugs in. I'm gonna see if we can get that out. Also, right next to that on the side is a fairly large-looking electrical connector. Also, over on this side, there's this box with a purple plug. I'm not sure if it's purple on all models, but on ours it's purple and it goes up into the dash. And it's just right in the middle on the floor. You might have to take your center console out if you have that.
This is what, Nissan calls a super multiple junction. I don't know what Chevy calls it, but...
A big-ass plug.
Yeah, probably. There's a bolt head in the middle, which turned out to be 9/32, I think. And so you just loosen that up, and then when it starts to act funny, like it's out but it doesn't want to completely be out, then you just grab the outside of this and wiggle it until the fucker comes out. And if you need to, you can remove this thing down here, these little tabs at the bottom. You just jam a screwdriver in there, and then that lets you get those bastards out, but you don't need to do that, and it's just more of a pain in the ass than you need to do. So
yep. We've got an airbag connector here. You can tell because they're bright yellow on the side of the super multiple junction bracket and what fucks it. So I'm just going to pop the clip off so that I'm not working by braille.
We have already disconnected the battery and all that.
Yeah. Pull it under here. Okay, so we've got this, let's see. Okay, so this
thing comes through to stop you from unplugging it. So you need to get that the hell out of the way. This is different from the other one, which is unhelpful. This is the part where I jam a flathead screwdriver through my finger. There we go. Pull that out of there, and then that should push in and go out.
Like so.
All right, and my only regret is that I didn't have a little firecracker handy to light and make Zach jump. Okay, endless fun behind the dashboard. We have disconnected the cable or the vac lines that went to that. That go to this.
Something important to mention is we did undo, there's an electrical connection, again, not sure if it's in all models, but for the vacuum knob, this one has a electrical connector, that one to that, just pull that apart so we can yoink this out.
So that's a part. And then there's this bugger, which is the antenna, and that had to come out. It had a clip right there, where you can see that little, right there. And it looks like we have to undo one little fastener down here to get it out as well, because otherwise we'll tear that off and then Zach will be without the radio and he will be sad.
Aha, I got her out.
There's that. So yeah, once we got all the connectors out, we just kind of lifted it up, finagled it over the steering wheel. It would have been easier with that out, but then we would have had to take that out. So.
Yeah. And like you just said, it would have been a heck of a lot easier. I did have to pull the, again, adjustable. If you don't have an adjustable steering wheel, you might need one. I'm just going to say that right now.
Yeah.
But with mine, I literally had... I had it at the lowermost rung, but if you pull the lever and you bring it down just a bit, there's a section where it'll go down a little further, but it usually springs back up into place. I had to bring it down to that level and hold it there to get it to jump off, but we pulled it out the passenger side.
Yeah, and you will need two people for this.
Yes.
One person trying to get this out, you will break something.
And there's just
probably
so
your spine
stuff. And this is a great opportunity to clean up everything. And since we've got a better look, this is the fastener that was holding that antenna on.
Yeah.
That right there.
That little bastard.
And yeah, let's go throw this somewhere and start our next challenge.
Yeah. Personally, I think dashboards are overrated. This is just better.
Yeah, this look at all this space. Yeah, well, we got some cleaning to do.
Yeah. But here we are down into the guts of what's wrong with this thing. So you can see there's a vacuum mafuxet here that's not there anymore that moved this. That was dicked. There's a vacuum mafuxet here that moves this. It still works. There's this little door down in here that's broken.
Want to mention, this is the other bracket that we were supposed to remove. As you can see, it is not necessary to remove. It might make things more of a pain putting it back together, but we'll burn that bridge when we get to it. Now we get to deal with this piece of crap.
I don't know what that is, but I hope it's not bad.
It's an electrical doohickey that was expensive. for Rock Auto.
Well, then let's definitely hope it's not bad. So we're looking at the vents in the middle of this thing. This front vent door thing, yeah, directs air through here or through here. And that one's okay. The actuator was shot, but the door itself is okay. It's this door back here that, as you can see, is broken. Zach's furiously working the shaft at the end of it, and it's not moving the inside thing because it's broken right there at the end. So now he gets to figure out how to get into that.
With a hammer!
I'd be game. Okay, so it has become obvious that this whole black box needs to come out. There was this 10 mil fastener under here. I got that out.
There's probably more. Mysterious black
box. Yeah, there's a mysterious black box.
Thankfully, they happily label the colors on the plugs that go into it. The purple plug went away with the dashboard.
Oh, you see that this is the... this is the chow unit.
Ah, chow. Okay.
Yeah, that's what makes you bacon and beans on the road. Too bad that's not working.
All right, Elliot's just picking up the bracket that the black box mounted up into.
These are 7:30 seconds, by the way.
Yeah, 7:30 seconds. Not 9:30 seconds, 7:30 seconds. The black box comes out because it's just got these
clips that hold it into place right there. You disconnect that one, and then there's a bottom one, then yank it out from the other end.
And then drop a fastener. Drop the fastener.
There's four of these. We're not sure if we really need to take this off, but there might be a mounting bolt behind it. We're not sure.
Yeah. God, it would suck to work on cars in a tropical country. I mean, we complain about mice. Right, you open it up, you find a tarantula just nomming on a bird behind somebody's dashboard.
That just holds off, revealing nothing! Yay!
Zach has found an infinite loop.
So, in the heater vent module replacement, which is the big black ugly bastard, it says here, let's see, step number 5, remove the floor air outlet, which is a duct that sticks up underneath it. In the air outlet replacement floor, the first step is to remove the heater vent module. Refer to module replacement. So when we go back to our module replacement, we get down to step 5, remove the floor air outlet, refer to air outlet replacement floor pickup. So, of course, we turn back to our air replacement outlet floor pickup, and so on and so forth.
Okay, so because the black box contains the heater mafuxit, we need to take off the heater hose lines.
What did you get yourself on?
See that little...
Ooh! The bastards.
Well.
Right. Yeah, it should be fine. I'll grab you a spark plug to jam in the end.
Okay, the heater core is disconnected and the one fastener we can get it from the outside is out. So, where are the 4 or 5 other fasteners?
Lord only knows.
Okay, we found one more fastener here by the evaporator.
Housing for the evaporator collar. Not sure if it'll actually do anything, but it looks like it might.
We're not 100% sure if what we're doing is actually doing anything on the inside, because I'm not entirely sure these bolts go all the way through the firewall, but we do need to eventually take this piece out anyways, so if nothing, we are moving forward, or at least sideways.
Not sure if better or exactly the goddamn same.
Hey, I know, maybe it's spring clips. Let's just yank on it.
All right, well, the inside has so far flummoxed us. It's still held on by something in one spot, so we're taking off this box here to see if we can get at it from the outside.
But again, we're mostly doing this partly out of desperation and partly because this needs to come off anyways.
Yeah, this thing's getting a new air con system.
Fun fact, there's bolts running underneath the plastic case for that thing. And the easiest way, The easiest way to do it is to go in through the wheel well, lift in around back behind the thing, yank out whatever the hell that stuff is, and get the bolts on the very bottom line from there. Did that hit the floor?
I heard it hit the floor.
Thank you.
And then there's that one.
Yep. The problem.
That bastard. Right next to the wheel well and the wiring harnesses, and you can't get a socket down there, and surprise, surprise, we didn't have a wrench small enough.
The solution, a special tool.
I made a special tool. A crow can make tools. A human, god damn it. A crow can use tools. A human can make tools.
Good news, everyone. We found the bastard.
And it is a bastard.
It is right exactly behind the exhaust manifold.
And I'm trying not to get worried because I've been cranking on this son of a bitch for like a couple of minutes now and it doesn't seem to be getting any looser.
We have problems.
Yes. We have bigger problems than the problems that we already have.
We might have a solution. I got the ratcheting wrench on and we might be able to capture the thread so we can get the nut off. But that does involve bringing out the goose.
This is some kind of threaded insert from something that happened to have a hex end on it that fit the stud.
The star bit on the stud. Now, yeah. The only reason that we had to do this,
this fuckery,
because was because the threaded insert on the inside, the one that's impossible to reach, was spinning around when you were trying to take the nut off.
Yeah, so the whole thing was spinning. You spin the nut and it's spinning the threaded bit as well. So we reached this thing up in there, put it over the end, and that held it in place. We could get off with a wrench. Well, this box has given us a ride and a half, but I got this out from back behind it. Seems to go into the inside. Funny little thing here. No improvement.
Improving, but still held in.
Okay, so there must be one more back there. Let me...
at least one more.
Yeah, let me stick my hand back in the old Sarlacc pit of doom here. Okay, well, Operation Unthinkable is about to commence, and no, that doesn't mean I get to take a hacksaw to it. It means Zach is removing the fender. This is what you gotta do to replace a vent in the air conditioner. This is what you gotta do to get to this bastard.
Yeah, see that fastener right there? Never would have gotten to it otherwise.
No, I never would have even known it was there. Remember how we were all happy we could get to the bolts now? Look at that little bastard. Little bastard tucked way back in there. Well, remember how much trouble we were having getting that open? Turns out there's one more fastener buried in here that you can't get to until you take off the fender and the inner fender well. Okay, so that came off with a bunch of 10 mils. And now, come off. So, gonna replace your damn blower motor. You gotta take the fender off. And once you get this thing out, there's one more little tiny bugger down here, holding on that collar that holds on the bottom there. So, you can't just open her up and slide her out unless somebody's already cut this. So, this is the one that was giving us hell earlier. Pretty sure it's not supposed to be like that. But I'm not seeing what the hell else is holding that thing in.
We fucking got it. So yeah, that one was stripped out.
The gave us a fuck of a lot of trouble.
Threaded inserts, such as that.
Yeah, had another one right there. These were giving us trouble, so they were hanging up on their way out. I had to disconnect one more back line to get her out. Just pulls off. Yeah, so here is our...
Pushing and pulling and shoving from the other side seemed to help.
Yeah. Yeah, it really helped to have somebody else beating on these.
Yeah, flush won't do her any harm.
Hopefully we can put it all back together again.
Suddenly, Zach reverts to his Kermit the Frog, perhaps as a defense mechanism.
Yeah.
Outcome compressor.
Compressor. Filled with oil. And other related schmoo.
I just ran some water through the heater core to make sure that's good and clean, it seems to be. Right, so now we just need to undo all of these little bastards that hold it together so that we can open it up and replace the bad vent arm. All right, these bastards are 7/32. Okay, well, most of them just come out around the outside, but you also have to take off, it looks like, the cover for the heater core, and then there's one down there in that little recess. Okay, we also need to remove this little clippy bastard that's holding this actuator to this broken bit. Okay, so that's got it all unfastened. The only remaining problem now is this foam crap that seals it against the firewall. It appears to be glued on, and I don't want to screw up the glue, so I'm just going to slit it with a razor blade at either side of the part so I can pull this damn thing apart. And just that easily, you can split it apart so that you can get to your defrost door. Remember, we had to disconnect the air conditioner, remove the fender to get to this bastard. All right, this cranky bit has to come off of the end here.
You can see it's got a little tab in that hole there. You just get that with a flathead screwdriver from above and then pull. And then this. Well, here we see old and dickered and new and designed exactly the same way. Okay, so you can kind of see it. I've got the first three openings there filled up with JB Weld and a piece of masking tape over it to contain it while it cures. And then hopefully that'll be a little more durable. Zach, meanwhile, is cleaning up some rusty bollocks. It was in that area there where it looks like a battery decided at one point that it had seen enough of this world. Okay, so if you're replacing these actuators, it's a little clip that you have to get off. Okay, you see this little Barbie thing here? That's how it hooks in, this clip. So yeah, that just, real easy to install. I say failing. Just needed two hands. Well, the new actuator for this one came with a new end for it here. See, they went from the annoying clip to a different annoying clip. You can also see how it works here. It's sprung, and it's sort of a double-acting vacuum thing, so it can pull it one way, seal off that way, or pull it the other way, seal off that way. Kind of ingenious in a hokey-ass sort of way. All right, so this is our please don't break again fix here. Just did a second coat right, a couple of pinholes, but basically just filled it with JB Weld, put some tape over it so that it would more or less stay where I put it. And yeah, hopefully that gets rid of some of the weakness right there. Apparently what happens is just the actuator's too strong and this thing bottoms out and the actuator's not bottomed yet and it just ends up snapping this thing right off at the neck. So with any luck, again, this will add a little more rigidity to it. We did consider drilling a hole down the end and sticking a piece of coat hanger in there, but there's so little actual material here because Chevy was being cheap. Comparing the new part to the old part, you can see they actually made it slightly more difficult to put the new part in. I'd have to grind that down. Took a little grinding, but it's in. There's that bastard installed. Make sure this clicks. And then the spring is on properly. So it should move one way or the other way. I imagine it's this way that it breaks. All right, well, once you've cleaned it out, replaced whatever actuators you need to, and maybe replaced your heater core, need to put the top back on. Now, there are pins that go in the ends of these, and those need to line up, and that needs to line up, and so this is going to be kind of a pain in the ass. I'm going to do it, and then I'm going to tell you if there's any easy way that I find of doing it. So, turns out the way to do it, slowly stick it together. The bits that are going to give you trouble, this might try to give you trouble, but it can only do so much. This door and this door are going to give you trouble. This is the harder one to get to, so get that one lined up first. You can stick your hand in through there. And this one will give you trouble, but you can get to it real easy because that's the door right there. The tops of these have little cylinders sticking up, and then this top piece here has little pins that stick down into them. Get them in there, make sure everything's moving freely, and then you got a whole bunch of 7/32 to do up. So, as an amusing aside, when these things fail, generally, you know, the little rubber diaphragm inside rips. This one was odd because it's got a vacuum port on either side so it can suck in or suck out. And this side seemed fine, this side had a massive leak. Turned out that this little boot here is essential for this thing to work. And it was just kind of popped out like that. So we just popped it back in and it works fine. So it's going in Zach's spares bin of doom.
I have removed compressor.
Condenser.
Condenser. I have also removed that as well. On the bottom, there wasn't anything aside from these rubber feet to keep it from banging around. And on the top, I can demonstrate here. These basically just sat on the corners somehow, like so. And then they bolted in. They just
mount up here and over there, either end. And that and the hoses, and that's pretty much all that holds them in.
Excellent. Didn't have to drain coolant, oil, or tranny fluid.
Yeah. If you take out just enough stuff, you can just barely nudge it out of the way. I'd be very careful, of course, because these are hard lines and such, but it is possible.
Cool.
Also, this plastic trim piece, should be noted, has a bunch of these annoying little plastic pop fasteners. And they're annoying as heck. That's where a good pair of these trim plier things comes in real handy.
Cool.
And the will to break a few.
Remember, before you put in a new core, make sure that you put the little rubber thingies in first. All right. Condenser's back in. Air box, which had to go out to get the radiator budget, is going back in. And, yeah. Installation of the compressor is a highly technical process that involves setting it down on the thing, making sure it doesn't wiggle, and then bolting it up. Does seem to have a slight rock to it.
It's very slight rock.
A lot of what we've read about aircon compressors notes that if the bracket isn't perfectly flat and you tighten down the compressor, you can cause issues. Well, something wasn't completely flat here, so we're trying to make it flat with shims.
Ooh.
Okay, so a single piece of foil tape has
saved the day.
Yeah. Hopefully save the compressor bearings. Okay.
We have one of the most adorable little oil bottles known to man, which is of course sealed for our protection.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this one came pre-charged with 3 ounces of oil and requires 8 ounces to fill. I have 8 ounces here, so we're going to need to add 5 on a vaguely level surface.
So just to confirm, this thing ships with oil in it, and we need to put more oil in it before we connect the rest of the system. And we put the oil directly into the compressor.
Yes.
Okay.
And the compressor came with a pink tag saying, fill here.
Okay. Presumably that's the output side then.
Or something to that effect. And also, I think we're supposed to, like, try to cycle it if we can.
Hmm. We've run into an unexpected difficulty.
The hose is foul.
Uh-huh. On the case. Okay, so one tip, the bolt that these come with that's holding the little cover on, that's not the bolt you used to put the hoses on. Use your old bolt. The new one is too short. One last step on this interior thing before we put it back. This is the one that gave us a pain in the ass. I'm thinking what happened was that as we unscrewed the nut, it just unscrewed this whole thing from the plastic, which was unhelpful. So, yeah, we used our brand new special wrench to tighten it back down and rub some J&B weld on the threads so it's not going damn well anywhere in the future.
All the mounts that we found that tie into the inside black air box are here, there, and over there by your heater core hoses.
There's also the thing there.
Right.
This one with the double spiral thread goes there, where you can't get to it.
So yeah, I'm just going back and forth on these because we couldn't get this thing to seat all the way back on, just setting it in place. So yeah, that kind of figures this thing's just a pain in the ass. So I'm just easing it in with these, and it seems to be working fine.
So yeah, never mind, this goes on the outside of the black box. When you put the inside thing in, there are only 2 bolts you need to put in. The one is the one by the heater hoses, and the other one is the one that you can see that's going to be inside the box. Okay, here we see Zach installing one side of the box thingy here. Zach's putting the little 7/32 bastards back in.
Yay!
Well, Zach pulled the orifice tube expansion valve, whatchamahoos it, out of the this. And we're noticing it's got an awful lot of big old metal chunks on it. So where are we at?
Well, we've got this hose to connect up to this. Well, this connects to that, actually. And that connects to that. And this hose connects between the
bottom port
condenser and that one. And after that, the dashboard.
We have a momentous occasion.
A complete, brand new AC system.
Dun, dun, dun.
Notice how I declined to say functional yet.
All right, sketchy China special pump is running.
Sketchy China special gauges are gauging.
All right.
So you can see there.
Yeah, it's pulling vacuum. Nice. We need to get the dashboard back into this son of a bitch. Before the dashboard goes in, of course, make sure you've got all your back connections in. Make sure that the little connection, make sure this bastard is hooked up. That appears to be vacuum supply for the whole thing. If you don't put that in, you won't be happy. All right, the dashboard is back in. It's sort of, you have to put it in and then pivot it up, and there are little pins on either side, and that was a pain. Got the antenna rerouted. We're just gonna bolt it up and then get all of this electrical and vacuum bollocks plugged back in. The nice thing about not having wiped the dust off of the dashboard is that we've got these lovely witness marks to show us which fasteners went where. All right, so once the dashboard is in place, start getting the electrical back together and
reinstall the braces and various other accoutrements.
Yep. Super multiple junctions next.
I'll tell you what will make things a little easier. There we go. Okay.
Pro tip, make sure your e-brake's on.
There.
All right, so these tweetery bastards. Two bolts there, two holes there. And the Phillips screws go through there and there. Well, the dashboard's coming back together. We've decided to rerun the vacuum test because we realized, or Zach realized, that he hadn't quite tightened those things down, so.
What I did is, I think this was my mistake, I watched a video on how to do it properly, and I noticed the guy, I thought opening the valves, they had to pop out like that, but they're Schrader valves, and I think what actually happens is you screw it so it pops in and opens the Schrader valve inside.
So we may have just been vacuuming down the lines rather than vacuuming down the system.
And it's not a bad idea to let it run for a while anyways on with the vacuum, just to make sure that the system, there's no moisture in the system.
Yeah. Yeah, it's building a lot more slowly this time.
That makes sense.
Yeah. So one thing to make sure you don't forget, there's a black connect, there's a white connector hanging down that goes to the aux 12 volt stuff. Then there's a black connector hanging down that goes, you can't see it, but there's that actuator, the one electrical actuator for the HVAC behind the vacuum one there. You can get to it if you have long fingers and don't mind using them, but otherwise it's kind of a bitch. So yeah, get that before you put the dashboard back on.
Yay.
Getting stuff out of the floor, which is new. Yeah, that definitely goes away. And there's definitely stuff coming out of the floor.
Wonderful.
Now the big one, defrost. Hey, defrost.
Yay.
I don't hear any snapping noises.
We have the nice gauge thing, but we don't have the adapter for it, so we've got the crap gauge thing. And we're just gonna put two cans of R134A into it because Zach did the math and it's gonna take two in a bit.
Yep, sticker says 1 pound, 12 ounces. A pound is 16 ounces, so two cans should be good. I have a third can. That's where we're gonna have to fiddle around a bit.
Run the gauges, watch the pressures. So, the air blows cold and it blows out all the right holes.
I think we've got the balance more or less okay to where it'll pop on for a bit, pop off for a bit, pop on.
Yeah, it wouldn't be a bad idea to get the right adapter and then check the pressures again this summer when it's actually properly hot out.
Yeah. But for now, it blows cold air. It seems to run without any grindy, smacky.
Yeah, hell, your defroster might even work better.
Yeah. All the vents seem to work. I think we have done nothing but improvements so far.
And now for the real question. Was it worth taking the fender off?
It was. It really, honestly to God, was.
Good. All right, so, everyone out there, yes, it's worth taking the fender off.
One last final thing before we sign off. When you're dealing with air conditioning components, specifically the gauge set, be very careful when you're disconnecting everything. I had the gauge set off, away from the engine, disconnect everything, and I was pulling the fittings apart from the hoses, and there was still pressure, there was still refrigerant in the system, so make sure you're wearing gloves.